Library for having me. I want to thank y'all for showing up on a beautiful Saturday. And I think I'm going to start, because there are some little ones in the audience, by reading from a book called Pecan Pie Baby. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to talk a little about the inspiration behind the books. I'm going to read from, I think, three or four books, including Each Kindness and Brown Girl Dreaming. And then you get to ask me some questions. Is that cool?
Yeah.
So this is a book called Pecan Pie Baby. And it's a book I wrote when we were pregnant with my son, who is now 9 years old. And when we found out that he was going to be a boy, my daughter, who's now 15, she was about 5 at the time, she decided that she didn't want a baby after all. Because she had wanted a little sister, and since we weren't having a girl, she decided she wasn't going to have a baby. She didn't want to have it. She wanted to continue to be an only child. And so I decided to write a book about a woman who's having a baby, and the little girl is jealous of the baby that's coming. So it's not my story. It's not a biography. It's not an autobiography. It's fiction, but it's fiction that's, of course, been inspired by something true to me. And one thing you should know is I do not like pecan pie. So that's a main part of the book. And the book was originally called The Ding Dang Baby. And it's illustrated by a woman named Sophie Blackhall, who did the Ivy Bean books. She also won the Caldecott for a book she did called, it was the Bear Book. I forgot the name of it. I'm sure someone can help me out. But anyway, she won the Caldecott for that. And she also lives in Brooklyn, which is where I live. I live in Brooklyn in a neighborhood called Park Slope, and there are tons of writers in our neighborhood. And there's a writer named Colson Whitehead who just won the Pulitzer, and one joke he makes is he says, you come across the Brooklyn Bridge and they hand you an MFA, which is a Master of Fine Arts for writers. And it's a joke because there's so many writers in Brooklyn, and there are actually a lot of children's book writers in my neighborhood. So, just as summer started leaving us and the leaving brought all those colors to the trees, Mama pulled out my winter clothes. Time to give away the things that are too small, I said to Mama. This didn't used to be a mini dress. Mama smiled. Let's keep it, Gia. And I knew what was coming next. More talk about the ding-dang baby. I don't know why we have to keep my old stuff, I said. We do. You do too know why, Mama said back. Because there's another baby coming soon. Not real soon, right? I said. Probably by the time the first snow is on the ground, Mama said. Cool, huh? Not really. I looked out at the falling leaves and made a silent wish that winter would come and go quickly without any snow. Sorry. Mama touched my hair. I'll tell you one thing. This baby sure loves itself some pecan pie. It's asking for some right now. Well, I love pecan pie, I said, and you love pecan pie, so that baby's just being a copycat. In the kitchen, Mama cut us both a big slice. By the time it was jacket weather, everybody was talking about that baby. You want a boy or a girl, my friends Juna and Omi said, ask at recess. And my friend Trixie said, let's play Mama's Having a Baby. Mama's having a baby. Daddy's going crazy. If it's a boy, give it a toy. If it's a girl, give it a curl. Wrap it up in toilet paper. Send it down the escalator. First floor, stop. Second floor, stop. Third floor, you better watch out because S-T-O-P, spell stop. So has anyone seen the name Trixie in any other books? Think hard. So there's Trixie. So in Knuffle Bunny 2, Mo put my daughter Toshi. And so when I wrote Pecan Pie Baby, I put Trixie in it. So Mo and Trixie and Cheryl were some of the writers, illustrators who lived in my neighborhood. When my friend Michaela slept over, she said, your mama better not put that baby in my bed, right? Because then where will I sleep? Dang, I said, that ding-dang baby's trying to take the place of my sleepover friend. Even my aunties were baby crazy. When they came over for our weekly sweet tea and toast party, they both drank their tea in one huge gulp and ate their toast in two bites without any of them saying, isn't the weather marvelous, darling? Then they got up and sat with Mama talking about that baby. All fall, the leaves kept dropping off the trees and the days got shorter and shorter. One Saturday, a huge box came, and all afternoon, my uncles were in my room scratching their heads and fussing with each other as they put the baby's crib together. I want to show you something. At school, my teacher read a book about a girl who was going to be a big sister, and when she finished reading, everybody looked at me. So right here, there's a boy with a red tie on. Can y'all see him? Well, you can look at him later. And he's sound asleep. This is a kid named Eggie. And this is actually Sophie Blackhall's son. And so he's actually now about 16 now, but she put him in a book, in the book. And when he was a little kid, he always wanted to go to school with a bow tie on. When my cousin came to visit with her new baby, she put the wiggly thing in my lap and said, "You sure are ready to be a big sister, aren't you?" "Not really," I said, handing the wiggling baby back to her. One night, Grandma took us out to a fancy restaurant. She kept fussing over Mama. "Eat your greens," she said, "and you should order some Brussels sprouts for the baby." Mama made a face and we laughed. "Uh-uh, Mom," Grandma, I said, "it's not a sprouts baby. This baby loves itself some pecan pie." So for dessert, me and Mama shared a piece. "Are you getting enough rest?" Grandma asked. "You know I can take Gia. That baby needs you now." I wanted to say, "I need Mama now." Then Mama reached over and rubbed my back. Me and the baby need Gia with us. And even though I didn't like when Mama talked about the ding-dang baby, her hand felt nice on my back. Some days I sat on my stoop thinking about all the years it was just me and Mama, about us drinking cocoa together and telling silly stories, about the mornings I jumped into her bed when it was still blue-pink outside, snuggling up to her while she kept trying to sleep. Now that baby was gonna change everything. When my cousins came for Thanksgiving, all anybody could talk about was baby this and the baby that. "I'm so sick of the ding-dang baby," I said. But they just kept on talking. And maybe I didn't say it loud enough because everyone kept laughing and making plans for when the baby got here. "I'm so sick of the ding-dang baby," I said. Everybody got quiet and Mama sent me to my room. Upstairs, I got that teary, choky feeling. And even though there were a whole lot of people in my house, I still felt real, real, real alone. Later on, Mama came upstairs and sat beside me. I didn't look at her. "You know what I'm gonna miss most when the baby comes, Gia?" Mama said. "I know what I'm gonna miss most," I said. "My whole life before the ding-dang baby?" Mama said, "Yeah, before the ding-dang baby." "You know what," Mama said, "I'm gonna miss that too." "For real, Mama?" "For real." "Those were the good old days," I said. "I guess I'm gonna have to tell the ding-dang baby all about them." Then Mama hugged me and we sat like that, just being all cuddly with that ding-dang baby jumping around in Mama's belly. After a while, Mama said, "It's cold out there tonight. Weatherman's calling for snow." "Then let's go downstairs and eat some dessert before that ding-dang pecan pie baby gets here," I said. Mama laughed because she knew, just like I knew, that the three of us loved ourselves some pecan pie. Southeast Asian, but I never came across books where the people where diverse families were represented. And I thought it was really important for me as a writer to represent the world the way I see the world and the way I live in the world. Because, and I think it's also important that all people's stories get told. And so when I choose an illustrator, I can't talk to them at all. I can't say draw a girl with her pregnant mom on the cover. I can't say draw an uncle who's Latino and another uncle who's black. I give the illustrator the words and they draw whatever they want to. But I broke the rule with this book. And I said, when you illustrate this book, Sophie, I want it to look like my family. And I want it to be a very diverse group of people coming together. And then I shut up and let her go to work on it. And I think it's, I wrote a book called The Other Side, and it's about a segregated town and two girls, one black, one white, who end up sitting on this fence even though they're not allowed to. And eventually they become activists and they change the world, right? So with their actions, the town is no longer, the fence that had all this power of keeping people apart is not doing that anymore. And so, I wanted to show how young people can be activists and how living in homogeneous communities where everyone looks exactly alike, there's something not quite right about that. There's something very dangerous about that because suddenly you become afraid of people who look different from you, who practice different religions from you, who love differently than you do, who walk differently than you do. And so much of the writing I've done over the many, many years I've been writing, is to try to represent people as fully human and as having a right to be able to walk through the world safely. And, you know, I'm living right now in a country that feels very unsafe sometimes. And I think literature, one thing literature can do for us is remind us of the importance of seeing people as people. So this is a book called Each Kindness. And I wrote this book when my daughter was in second grade. I was in her classroom, and these two girls, this girl came in, and she had on a pair of pants, and I thought they were the coolest pants in the world, but I'm a grown-up, so I don't know anything. And I said, those are really cool pants, and she said, thank you. Then another girl in the class said, when she hadn't heard me compliment the girl, and she said, when she saw the pants, she's like, I can't believe you even wore those pants to school today. And for the rest of the day, the girl who was wearing the pants, she either tried to sit at her desk, or when she walked around, she tied her jacket around her pants to try to hide them. And it broke my heart. And I decided that I wanted to write a book about kindness because it's so important in the world. And my mom died suddenly, and I realized when my mom died that you think you're going to have all these chances to say stuff to people, and you don't know if they're going to be there the next day or not. And so you might lose those chances. So between the mean girls and the sudden loss, I decided to write a book about the importance of kindness. So my family, every night when we sit down for dinner, we have to say something that we're grateful for and something we did during the day that was kind. And my son always lies and says something like, I was nice to the dog, which he usually isn't. But we all try to come up with something. And it doesn't have to be a big thing, just, you know, some small thing that made a difference for someone else in the world. And being conscious of that helps you do that. Or knowing you're going to get in trouble if you come to the table at night and haven't done anything helps you do it. That winter, snow fell on everything, turning the world a brilliant white. When I finish this book, remind me to talk to the young writers in the room about something. One morning, as we settled into our classroom, the classroom door opened and the principal came in. She had a girl with her and said to us, this is Maya. Maya looked down at the floor. I think I heard a whisper, hello? Her coat was open. We all stared at her. Her coat was open and the clothes beneath it looked old and ragged. Her shoes were spring shoes, not meant for the snow. A strap on one of them had broken. Our teacher, Miss Albert, said, say good morning to the new student. But most of us were silent. the only empty seat was next to me, and that's where our teacher put Maya. And on that first day, Maya turned to me and smiled, but I didn't smile back. I moved my books, my chair, and myself a little further from Maya. And every day after that, when Maya came into the classroom, I looked away and didn't smile back. My best friends that year were Kendra and Sophie. Each day we walked around the schoolyard, our fingers laced together, whispering secrets into each other's ears. One day, while we were near the slide, Maya came over to us. She held open her hand to show us the shiny jacks and tiny red balls she'd gotten for her birthday. "It's a high bouncer," she said, but none of us wanted to play. So Maya played a game against herself. That afternoon, when we got back into the classroom, Maya whispered to me, "I bet you can't guess who the new jacks champion of the world is." Behind me, Andrew whispered, "Chloe's got a new friend, Chloe's got a new friend." "She's not my friend," I whispered back. The weeks passed. Every day we whispered about Maya, laughing at her clothes, her shoes, the strange food she brought for lunch. Some days Maya held her hand out to show us what she brought to school that day. A deck of cards, pickup sticks, a small tattered doll. Whenever she asked us to play, we just said, "Nope." The great days grew warmer and warmer. The pond thawed. Grass began growing where snow had once been. One day Maya showed up to school wearing a pretty dress and fancy shoes. But the shoes and the dress looked like they belonged to someone before Maya. "I have a new name for her," my friend Kendra whispered. "Never knew. Everything she has looks like it came from a secondhand store." We all laughed. Maya stood by the fence. She was holding a rope but did not come over to ask us if we wanted to play. After a while, she folded it double, rolled the ends around each hand, and started jumping. She jumped around the whole schoolyard without stopping. She didn't look up once. Just jumped, jumped, jumped. The next day, Maya's seat was empty. When we came into the classroom, in class that morning, we were talking about kindness. Miss Albert had brought a big bowl into the class and filled it with water. We all gathered around her desk and watched her drop a small stone into it. Tiny waves rippled out away from the stone. "This is what kindness does," Miss Albert said. "Each little thing we do goes out like a ripple into the world." Then Miss Albert let us each drop the stone in as we told her what kind things we had done. Joseph had held a door for his grandmother. Kendra had helped change her brother's diaper. Even mean old Andrew had done something. "I helped carry teacher's books up the stairs," he said. Miss Albert said it was true. I stood there holding Miss Albert's rock in my hand, silent. "Even small things count," Miss Albert said, but I couldn't think of anything and passed the stone on. Maya didn't come to school the next day, or the day after that. Each morning I walked to school slowly, hoping this would be the day Maya returned, and she'd look at me and smile. I promised myself this would be the day I smile back. "Each kindness," Miss Albert said, "makes the whole world a little bit better." But Maya's seat remained empty, and one day Miss Albert announced to the class that Maya wouldn't be coming back. Her family had to move away, Miss Albert said. Then she told us to take out our notebooks, that it was time for spelling. That afternoon, I walked home alone. When I reached the pond, my throat filled with all the things I wished I would have said to Maya. Each kindness I had never shown. I threw small stones into it over and over, watching the way the water rippled out and away, out and away. Like each kindness done and not done, like every girl holding a small gift out to someone, and that someone turning away from it. I watched the water ripple as the sun set through the maples, and a chance of a kindness with Maya became more and more forever gone. So when I wrote this book, how many of you feel sorry for Maya? How many of you feel sorry for Chloe? So when I wrote this book, I rewrote it probably about 15 times before it's the book you see here. And the first time I wrote it, I was thinking about Chloe. There's an academic a writer named Rudine Sims Bishop, Dr. Rudine Sims Bishop. And she writes about the importance of kids having both mirrors and windows, that you want to open up a book and see some reflection of yourself in it, right? And you can go, oh, like, that's my house. Oh, like, that's my family. Oh, that's kind of like the city I live in, or that's my school. And you, so those are mirrors when you can relate to the characters or you can relate to something about the book. And a window is when you open up a book and you see a whole new world that you never imagined. And she talks about how kids should have both mirrors and windows and sliding glass doors so you could walk into those worlds. And so when I was writing this book, I thought, huh, Maya, who is she going to be a mirror for? And if a poor kid opens up this book and sees Maya and sees this kid who's just kind of bullying and who's just kind of a sad sack and who just kind of doesn't get, then who eventually moves up and who moves away, they're gonna be like, man, that's jacked up. Like, that's you know, that's all I have to look forward to. So when I went back and rewrote it, I wanted to make sure that Maya landed on the page as someone who is very strong. So what happens when she plays jacks? Nobody plays with her. But when she comes back into the classroom, she has no competition. So she says, I bet you can't guess who the new jacks champion of the world is. So she's like, you know, forget you, if you're not gonna play with me, I have no competition and I'm gonna win this game. And then later on, when she looks over and she sees that they're not gonna jump with her. And so what she does is she jumps around the whole schoolyard without stopping. She didn't look up once, just jumped, jumped, jumped. And that's what Chloe sees as her last image of Maya, is a strong girl basically taking care of herself and saying, I'm not gonna let you guys break me. I think I could have had her just put down the rope and put her head down and walk sadly back into the classroom. But as a writer, I made a choice to show her as someone who was going to not only be an upstander, but someone who was going to say, you know what, I can do better than this. If I don't need someone who's going to mistreat me. And so in the end, it's Chloe who has lost the chance at a kindness with Maya. And for the writers in the room, I like to think of it as our responsibility as writers, every time we put a character on the page, to think about the mirrors and windows. Who's this character a mirror for? Is this character going to be someone who's a stereotype, or is this character going to be someone who's just pitiful, or is this character going to have a lot of layers to them and be someone that is not a victim in some way? Even if they are a victim, like there's a way you can create characters that are nuanced, that have a lot of layers. So I'm gonna read from Brown Girl Dreaming. And I'm just gonna read a couple of poems from this, and then you can ask me questions. So I wanna shout out to Izzy. So my friend Izzy is in the audience. She and my daughter go to summer camp together, which I think is great that she's in Paris and Toshi's in Brooklyn, and they meet up in New Hampshire every summer. So thanks for coming, Izzy. And Izzy's also a writer. So Brown Girl Dreaming, I have written all these books and I wanted to figure out how did I do that? And I decided that I was going to write it in verse, because that's how memory comes to us, right? It comes to us as these small moments with all this white space around it. It doesn't come as chapter one, chapter two, chapter three, chapter four. So when I started writing, I just wrote down all these memories I had from my own childhood and tried to figure out how it got me to telling my stories. And the crazy thing is, as I was writing it, I started seeing all my other books in it. I saw Coming On Home Soon. I saw Locomotion. Of course, I saw Showway. And on and on it went. So I'm going to read a couple of sections from this book. I was born in Ohio, as you find out by reading this. And then my family moved to Greenville, South Carolina, where my mom and dad separated when I was 2 months old. And my mom went back to South Carolina, where her mom and dad lived. And my dad stayed in Ohio, where his mom and dad lived. And then from South Carolina, we came to New York City. And we were part of what was known as the Great Migration. Maybe you'll learn about it in school, maybe you won't, but millions of African Americans left the South because it was such a bad place for them to be in, and moved to places like Chicago, California, New York City, where they could have better chances at jobs, where they could have better chances at buying homes, all of that kind of stuff. And so we moved to New York City as part of that Great Migration. And then the reason I know my dad so well, even though he and my mom separated when I was 2 months old, they got back together when I was 13. And then they stayed together for a long time. And so I don't think a lot of people do that, but they did it. I don't know if I recommend it, but February 12, 1963. I have the same birthday as Judy Blume and Abraham Lincoln. I am born on a Tuesday at University Hospital, Columbus, Ohio, USA, a country caught between black and white. I am born not long from the time afar from the place where my great-great-grandparents worked the deep, rich land, unfree, dawn till dusk, unpaid, drank cool water from scooped out gourds, looked up and followed the sky's mirrored constellation to freedom. I am born as the South explodes, too many people, too many years, enslaved, then emancipated, but not free. The people who look like me keep fighting and marching and getting killed, so that today, February 12, 1963, and every day from this moment on, brown children like me can grow up free, can grow up learning and voting and walking and riding wherever we want. I am born in Ohio, but the stories of South Carolina already run like rivers through my veins. So the one thing, I had to do a lot of research to figure out how to write this book. And one of the things that I realized, even though I had always known them, was that my grandparents on my father's side were named Hope and Grace. Which I thought, my grandfather was named Hope, so my brother was named Hope. Bless you, and Hope goes all the way back. And the first time I met a girl named Hope, I thought, why does she have a boy's name? And then after that, I realized the only boy Hopes I knew were the Hopes in my family. There might be more, but we have a long line of Hopes. So I'm going to read a couple of more. So I think it only exists in southern towns. There's a candy lady, and what it is, it's a lady, and she just sells candy out of her house. And so she'll have one room, like maybe in the living room or like off the back. You'll come to the back door, and in the kitchen, you'll be able to look into her kitchen, and she has all kinds of candy for sale. And I think back in the day, because there weren't stores everywhere, so you'd have to drive to get to a store or something, people would just have this enterprise and they sell candy, and you go there and you'd be able to get popsicles or different kinds of candies. And she was always called a candy lady. And every kid I knew who came from the South had a candy lady in their neighborhood. On Fridays, my grandfather takes us to the candy lady's house. Even though my grandmother worries he's going to be the cause of our teeth rotting right out of our mouths. But my grandfather just, I'm sorry, rotting right out of our heads. I really do write this. But my grandfather just laughs, makes us open our mouths to show the strong, herby teeth we inherited from his side of the family. The three of us stand there, our mouths open wide, strong white teeth inside, and my grandmother has to nod, has to say, they're lucky, before sending us on our way. The candy lady's small living room is filled with shelves and shelves of chocolate bars and gumdrops, Good and Plenty, and jujubes, moon pies and Necco wafers, lollipops and long red licorice strings. So much candy that it's hard to choose until my grandfather says, get what y'all want, but I'm getting myself some ice cream. Then the candy lady, who is gray-haired and never smiles, disappears into another room and returns a few minutes later with a wafer cone, pale yellow lemon chiffon ice cream dripping from it. Outside, even this late in the afternoon, the sun is beating down, and the idea of lemon chiffon ice cream cooling us, even for a few minutes, makes us all start saying at once, "Me too, Daddy, me too, me too, Daddy, me too." The walk home from the candy lady's house is a quiet one, except for the sound of melting ice cream being slurped up fast before it slides past our wrists, on down our arms, and onto the hot, dry road. So we called our grandfather Daddy. And I'm going to read two more. This is called Gifted. Everybody knows my sister is brilliant. The letters come home folded neatly inside official-looking envelopes that my sister proudly hands over to my mother. Odella has achieved, Odella has excelled at, Odella has been recommended to, Odella's an outstanding performance in. She is gifted, we are told, and I imagine presence surrounding her. I am not gifted. When I read, the words twist, twirl across the page. When they settle, it is too late. The class has already moved on. I want to catch words one day. I want to hold them, then blow gently, watch them float right out of my hands. And this last one I'll read is called Tobacco. I love my grandfather, and of all the children, he loved me the most. Summer is over, a kiss of chill in the southern air. We see the dim orange of my grandfather's cigarette as he makes his way down the darkening road. Hear his evening greetings and the coughing that follows them. Not enough breath left now to sing, so I sing for him in my head where only I can hear. Where will the wedding supper be? Way down yonder in the hollow tree. The old people used to say a pinch of dirt in the mouth can tell tobacco's story. What crops are ready for picking? What needs to be left to grow? What soil is rich enough for planting and the patches of land that need a year of rest? I do not know yet how sometimes the earth makes a promise it can never keep. Tobacco fields laid fallow, crops picked clean. My grandfather coughs again and the earth waits for what and who it will get in return. So who knows what that poem is trying to say, anyone? What that poem is talking about? Nothing you can say is wrong. So what does Grandpa do? Why is he coughing? You could call it out.
Because the tobacco is damaging his lungs.
The tobacco's damaging his lungs. So my grandfather was a smoker, and he was always singing when he would come home from work. And when we lived at my grandparents' house in the country, we could see him coming down the road, and he'd sing loudly all the way down the road. And the sicker he got, the more his lungs started giving out on him because of the tobacco. When he would try to sing, he would cough. And so what I'm saying here is not enough breath to sing, because you need breath to sing, right? To sing now. So I sing for him in my head where only I could hear. So I'm remembering the song he used to sing, which is Froggy Went A-Courting. And so from there, I go to the part, the old people used to say a pinch of dirt in the mouth can tell tobacco's story. So people would pick up the dirt and taste it. And by tasting the dirt, they knew if the crops were ready for picking. They knew if it was time to plant, if the land needed to rest a year, if they needed to plant in another part. And that was simply by tasting the dirt. So I'm telling, from talking about my grandfather using tobacco, I go to talking about the history of tobacco. And then from talking about the history of tobacco, I say, I do not know yet how sometimes the earth makes a promise it can never keep, right? So the earth it promises us life, but sometimes life ends quickly. Tobacco fields lay fallow, crops picked clean, so it's already been harvested. My grandfather coughs again, and the earth waits for what and who will get in return. So who's gonna get in return? My grandfather. So, you know, when we, in this days, as some of you know, people either cremated or buried. So eventually in the book, we end up burying my grandfather. So that's what the poem Tobacco is about. It's a history of tobacco. It's about my grandfather. And it's about the earth kind of breaking its promise to me about my grandfather. So who has questions? And again, nothing. in terms of talking about color, it's a good question how come it's still hard to talk about race and stuff. The reason I called it Brown Girl Dreaming was because of the history of how we talk about ourselves. So, you know, we went from being colored to being Negro, to being Black, to being people of color. I actually prefer people of color because when I think of people of color, I think of myself being connected to you, being connected to someone who's Asian, being connected to someone who's Indian. Like, you know, it really kind of creates a bigger group. And so I wouldn't have called this Black Girl Dreaming because it starts in the 60s when we were considered brown. And also because my grandfather always called me his pretty brown girl. So I think to call it Black Girl Dreaming would have made it a more kind of political book, more politically targeted, more politically skewed toward the 70s and 80s. And maybe if it was happening today, I would call it Black Girl Dreaming, but I don't think I would have, because one thing about saying Brown Girl Dreaming is a lot of different people are invited to the party. And I think that, you know, for the people who are not brown, the book becomes a window. For the people who are brown, the book becomes a mirror. You know, and it's funny because I think of you as brown. So I was at a reading, and there were a lot of there was a whole group of kids from they were actually from Pakistan who were reading the book. And they, you know, they were like, "This is our story." Like, but you're from Pakistan. This is, but it was a mirror for them in the way that they had never seen a book called Brown Girl Dreaming, and they call themselves brown. They were the Brown Girl Book Club, and I think it was about the gaze too, how other people saw them. So, talking about race, it's the reason I started out with Pecan Pie Baby. I think the more diverse your community is, the more comfortable you are talking about race across lines, and I think the conversation is so important to constantly have, because the more you talk about a thing, the more comfortable you get talking about it. So I think it is important. And again, I think we end up making mistakes until we learn. I'm not even going to say the word, but where they have the bread. And I said something in French, and I swear the woman literally winced. I'm like, come on, I'm trying. but I know in order to eventually be well-spoken, I have to make a lot of mistakes and stumble and have people wince at me. So. They are in chronological order now. This book took me 3 years and probably about 31 rewrites before it's the book you see here. And so much of that, when I didn't have stuff that I remembered anymore, I went down south and I interviewed my cousins and my aunts. Then I went to Ohio, I interviewed my dad. My aunt's a genealogist, so that's where I got all the Thomas Jefferson, Sally Hemings stuff from, and the World War and the Civil War stuff. And so then I had all these memories, and part of that was about putting them in the order, and that took a long time. So I start from before I was, I start from the day I'm born, right? Which of course I can't remember, but then for that I had to go and research what was happening when I was born, of February 12th, 1963, which was kind of, and it's funny because I was having lunch with my friend Toshi Regan, who's a singer who comes from this, history of civil rights. And I was complaining, I was in the middle of writing this, and I'm like, nothing was happening when I was born. And she's like, what are you talking about? The country was on fire. And so I realized then that I was born right in the middle of this enormous thing that that would eventually kind of tell the whole story, you know, create the whole narrative. So yeah, they are all memories and interviews, and then when you get to the back, there are all the pictures of my family. So the first inspiration for writing this book was I wanted to figure out how, I probably have one, I was sitting in my office, and we live in a brownstone, so it's four stories. I don't know if anyone's been to Park Slope, but it's, you know, it's vertical living. And my office is on the first floor, then the parlor, kitchen, my kids' bedrooms, the library, on and on. And I'm sitting in my office, and I filled the walls with the awards, because, you know, I've gotten all the Newberries and the Credit Scott Kings and the National Book Awards. And so I have just, we just renovated the house, and I'm putting all these awards up. And then I had two boxes of awards that I didn't have wall space for. And then I thought, do I put them in the library? And I finally just sat down and I'm like, how did I get here to this point in my life where I'm going to put these awards that I've always dreamed of having in boxes and put them in the basement because I don't have space to put them on the walls? And I just started looking back on my life and wanting to figure out how I got to the point of being a writer. I knew I wanted to be a writer since I was 7 years old. But I never thought I would eventually write so many books and win so many awards and be able to travel, like all the things that came with writing. And so I just started at the beginning. I mean, and that's what writers do. You start from the first moment that you can think of and you write it down. And so I started writing down. And the whole time I'm writing this book, I'm complaining. No one's ever going to read this. People, you know, why? Who cares about my life? And why would anyone want to read a book about a writer becoming a writer? And so then that was a whole other shocker when it got all the attention that it got, because I think it when you write very, very specifically, you can touch a lot more people than you can if you try to write really broadly. And I think Brown Girl Dreaming is very specific, and that's what I wanted to do. Because I wanted to show the softer side of grandma, right? Because grandma's like, it's an ugly old thing. She's like, we're not going to keep it. And then finally, you know, she's putting out the blanket and taking care of the cat. And it's funny because when I was growing up, we always had cats. And now we have a cat named Fred that's a black cat. And I realized a lot of my books I didn't have pets in. And so I knew, because it was such a spare story, that I had to put the cat in. And you know, a funny story about coming on home soon, when E.B. illustrated it the first time, if you look at a page that has all the snow-covered page, if you look very closely, you'll see all these telephone poles. And we're like, no, there were no telephone poles, you know, in that period, especially in that area. We went back and forth about it, and he finally whited it out with snow. But if you look closely, you can see the mistake the artist made. But by the time I wrote that book for the second or third time, I loved that cat. That was like my favorite character in the book. Mom wrote a lot of poetry, and my older brother wanted to be a writer, but he never developed the muscle. Because, you know, writing's a muscle. It takes a lot of discipline. But growing up, if you come from the South, you know, you throw a stone and you hit 20 storytellers, because there's so much sitting on the porch and telling stories and retelling stories. And that's my whole Southern family. But not necessarily people who publish.
So you grew up in the storytelling culture?
On the Southern side, yes. And, you know, when you read that book, I grew up Jehovah's Witness and Muslim. And so, and I think, you know, one thing about being a Jehovah's Witness is you had to do a lot of public speaking. and the two religions together made for a lot of stories in the neighborhood. So, yeah. Another Brooklyn is now being required reading. I felt so bad for my daughter because she had to read it in ninth grade. And she hadn't let many people know that I was her mom. And what else is required reading? I don't know. I know Another Brooklyn in a lot of colleges. And If You Come Softly is on a lot of reading lists. And there was one other. I can't remember what it is, but some of them are.
No, we're trying to put them on our reading.
Uh-huh.
So, just wondering which ones.
Yeah. I know in ninth grade, a lot of people read Miracles Boys alongside The Outsiders. Because, not ninth grade, I'm sorry, seventh grade. So whenever they read The Outsiders, I think my daughter read it in seventh grade and she had to read Miracles Boys and The Outsiders and do a comparison and contrast. Yeah, I think I would say all of my books are realistic fiction. There's some fantastical stuff sometimes, but most of it is realistic fiction. Except for, of course, Brown Girl Dreaming, which is a memoir. And last question? Teacher who said, when you choose a career, choose something you love doing because you're going to be doing it for the rest of your life. And writing was the thing that I could not imagine not doing for the rest of my life. So from a really young age, I didn't know how I was going to be a writer. I didn't know if I was ever going to be a full-time writer, if I'd have to have another job and write. But I knew writing was always going to be my end game, the goal. And I was telling the group last time, when I was a kid, I used to get in trouble for lying a lot, which means I wasn't a good liar because I would always get caught. But I had a teacher who said, instead of lying, write it down, because if you write it down, it's fiction. And I just thought, wow, you mean like this could be legit? Like I could actually lie and not get in trouble for it. And it is. I mean, so much, sometimes books are inspired, but so many of these books, these things have never happened to me. I've sat down and I said, what if, what if, what if, and started creating a narrative. And that's how the story gets on the page. Thanks, everyone.